at McCrindle, we are fascinated by people, including how they live, how they work, how they shop, and how they engage with the world around them. And one data set that reveals a lot about the living part of my former sentence is the RLB Crane Index, as it tells us a fair bit about where people live, why they choose to live in the places they do, and a look into where growth areas are. So joining me today to discuss these insights is McCrindle's Director of Solutions and McCrindle's Director of Cranes, effectively, Geoff Brailey. Geoff, welcome back to the podcast.
Oh, thanks, Ash. It's a great topic and it is important to count people, but this is just a bit of a fun way to look into the future of where will people live and be working and what transport will they be riding into the future. So I think the cranes is a great little snapshot into the future. So thanks for having me on.
Oh, my pleasure. And people might have picked up on that little kind of director of cranes there. It's a very like long-standing running joke among the team members at McCrindle that you love cranes. I think once one of the team members was doing something like a cake for your birthday and there was a crane involved. Like it's this kind of folklore effectively at McCrindle that you love cranes. I know that you love population, you love learning about people and communities. So I think this fits right in your brand, Geoff. So definitely happy to have you on the podcast today. But I'm keen for you as well, Geoff, I guess, to share with us and share with me a little bit about how this love of this area of cranes and how people live came about. I mean, I know you're a dad to three amazing kids, and so I'm sure you can back up the notion that, you know, young kids love to look at trains and cranes and garbage trucks and all that kind of structure related things. Would you say your love of cranes began at a very young age, Geoff?
Yeah, this is more a later in life story, but it was parenting a young boy. So my middle child, Samuel, we were riding a train and the new metro in 2019. And as we were cruising from Rouse Hill, heading towards Chatswood on that brand new, fantastic bit of infrastructure, we were counting the number of cranes, and he was only like three or four at the time. So just learning how to count using cranes in Sydney. And I thought there's got to be a report on there. And yeah, thank you to RLB for putting in the hard work and doing the collection and producing a report. And it's really, I think, a fascinating way to look at the future, as I mentioned. But it was really helpful as a dad to be riding the train, counting the cranes. And I've then just made up the silly little rhyme of it's all about the planes, trains and cranes, as you think about how people move and live and work. And yeah, diggers and cement mixers, they probably are another passion as well. When you got little children, you just see them everywhere, and garbage trucks. So yeah, the parenting brand was a part of the story here.
Yeah. Oh no, love to see it. So Geoff, how many cranes are currently in Australia according to this latest RLB Crane Index?
Yeah, it's a collection every 6 months. There's a count of the cranes across Australia, and so right now we're at 869 cranes, so a slight decline of 13 cranes in the last 6 months. So while the population growth has been enormous in that last 12-month period, the crane count's actually declined. And just to give some context, in New Zealand, there's currently 139 cranes, and they also declined by 5 cranes in the last 6 months. So it's an interesting period right now where we've got rapid population growth in these safe, prosperous countries like Australia and New Zealand, and yet the infrastructure needed is a little bit delayed with some of the construction challenges, supply shortage and economic conditions as well. So I think the crane story is a fascinating one, particularly here in Australia as we are beginning to go vertical across many of our cap cities. So it's a story of the literal rise of our cities in this great nation.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you've already alluded to a little bit of it, but I guess what significance does the number of cranes, does this data set hold for people like yourself, for other people who are invested or interested in, say, population and property? And what does it tell us about where people are living and where that investment kind of is going?
Yeah, the report's brilliant because it counts cranes by cities. Excuse me, I'm choking up on the excitement and emotion of crane count data. It's about the growing pains, I think, though, as well, because it shows where cranes are now, which will be potential residential or mixed use or transport, or even I loved in this latest report, one of the fastest categories of growth is in data centres being built, that there's cranes to build data centres. I thought that's a McCrindle moment right there for sure.
Yeah.
But really, I guess the crane lead indicator gives an opportunity to see into the future around where will people live. And so as demographers, the ability to plan infrastructure for the future is one of the key reasons people come to us at McCrindle. And so for town planners, for schools, for aged care, for health, this is certainly a key thing to know. Where is the infrastructure happening right now? And it's great in that report. It splits it by all the different types of cranes and by cities as well. And so, yeah, there's a great wealth of data in that report. So it's a huge shout out to RLB for their data.
Yeah, it's it does really definitely paint that picture, I think. And I know we've done some little visualizations for slides and other presentation and LinkedIn content. And it is interesting to see that correlation in terms of, like you said, where the investment's going, maybe where the pain points are. So next time for all the listeners, when you're looking out and you're driving around an area and you see a crane, I'm sure you'll think of this podcast and what all that means for that area. But I mean, Sydney and Melbourne, of course, we know are our most populated capital cities. Are there noticeable differences in crane numbers between these bigger cities in Australia in this latest release of this data, Geoff?
Yeah, that's right. And the cities that you might expect have a lot certainly do. Sydney's got 390 cranes, so it's leading the national count. But Melbourne is less than half that at 194 cranes.
Wow.
And then down again, less than half in Brisbane at 78, which is still... that's impressive, 78 cranes across the population in Brisbane. Perth has 45, though, so doing very well in Perth as the increase in Perth's. So it's a fascinating story. And Melbourne has had the biggest increase, rising with 16 new cranes, sorry, in that last 6 month period. So Sydney's has declined by 11.
Right.
And it's a real, I guess, story of the changing makeup of our city. In Sydney, one in three dwellings is an apartment building. So quite remarkable for the 5.4 million people calling this place home. It's a story of that vertical community. It's a changing way of living where we're now going to live in active, connected, vibrant communities that are vertical and relying particularly on public transport infrastructure for that transit-enabled development. And that's going to be the key to maintaining livability and providing affordable apartments that are connected, where there's potentially a little bit less car ownership, but you've still got great access to local amenity and other, whether it's work or recreation through public transport and transport as a service like Uber. We don't need to own a car. We can just hire one, buy one, subscribe to it. So plenty of access to the changing ways we live across Sydney and Melbourne with this latest crane count. And I think it really does show, while the crane count has declined slightly, the population growth is still strong. And it's a real challenge right now, I think, in Australia, where the demand for housing continues to keep up. Even today, the latest approvals for apartments and dwellings is showing that it's still pretty steady and it's actually declining for apartments. So we need to continue to work on the supply side of things because demand is strong. Brand Australia is fantastic and building for the future. This is where Australia really is, in these growing pains and construction. The Crane Index is a great indicator of that.
And it's really interesting. I mean, I wasn't expecting there to be such a big difference between Sydney and Melbourne in terms of the number of cranes. And it's interesting, I guess, it's highlights to me again, like when you said, 300, I think, and something for Sydney compared to 100 and something for Melbourne.
Yeah. 390 to 190 for.
Yeah, so. I was expecting them to be a bit closer in number, but then you mentioned Melbourne's kind of increased their number of cranes and Sydney's decreased in the number. So it's like if you look at it just numerically, that tells one story. If you look at, though, where... or how that's growing as a proportion of it was last time. You know, it's interesting the different stories that come out, the way you can look at the different kind of data. I think that's interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think Melbourne certainly is back on the number one podium position with population growth in the last demographic update from the ABS. And so Victoria is growing really strongly again, taking the largest population growth in the last 12 months, taking that crown off Queensland. So an interesting shift in where people are living, why they're living there, and certainly I think preparing for the future, we're going to see Melbourne approaching 8 million people in Melbourne by 2050, and Sydney reaching across Greater Sydney, and sort of the vision for Sydney is to expand into including Newcastle and Wollongong, so that North and South Sydney will actually have 10 million people across Greater Sydney by 2050. So some remarkable sort of future perspectives. But I think the big shift is that places like Melbourne are increasing the crane count, which is good to see, but it's still Sydney's leading Australia in terms of dwellings that are apartments in our cities. We've sort of got that what might be 80 or 90% are just detached dwellings, and so we love that backyard block which we've grown up with, has been the traditional Australian dream, but that is going to change as we move to more affordable and connected dwellings into the future. And so it's interesting that we're sort of building into existing cities, but I'd love to imagine a city in Australia's future that actually kind of has the opposite. It might have 80 to 90% of the dwellings are actually apartments and just 10 to 20% are kind of detached dwellings. The amount of pain and suffering I think people go through when you're converting an existing site into a vertical community, it's such a heartache for the community, and the construction and delays and challenges that presents, the mess, the noise, all the pollutions. But I think the opportunity to build new cities is one of those things. As we imagine Australia at 40 million people by 2050, we're going to need to think differently and build differently. And I think we'll see one day those crane counts will be amazing to see 1,000 in a place like Melbourne or 1,000 in a place like Sydney. The numbers will surely continue to rise.
Yeah, I think it's fascinating to, think about the future as well, like you said, and places that have this strong legacy and the people within them have this expectation of how they're going to build wealth and how they're going to live, and how that isn't actually maybe super realistic because of economic conditions, because of availability of space. I mean, I know we've done some research on behalf of a developer about the benefits of apartment living, and interestingly kind of reframing that great Australian dream, like you said, away from that house and land with the backyard to maybe something that's a bit more connected, accessible, closer to services and amenities. So yeah, it definitely takes bit of compromise in these kind of markets, which again kind of comes all back, and we can get this story out of this data set, which is fascinating. As we think about, I guess, the future, and even I guess, well, before we think about the future, if we look at these latest crane numbers, and like you mentioned, a slight dip in the crane numbers, what does that, I guess, indicate to you, Geoff, about the state of population growth, how that's interacting with construction trends, but also I guess the economic conditions that we're experiencing at the moment as a nation?
Yeah, I think the economic conditions are pretty challenging right now, where we've got governments that are coming out of the enormous and appropriate spend out of COVID and keeping lives and livelihoods with some of the mantras we heard from national and state leaders through that period, where governments just borrowed right up. And certainly I think right now there's a bit more of a concern about getting back into surplus with budgets and actual spending. So the opportunity to sink money and borrow money to prepare for the future is probably a challenge right now. And so a bit of budget pressure. We've also got inflation that's still challenging. It's slowly reducing, but still a pain point affecting all of us. And certainly the supply and labour shortage, kind of those tailwinds of that challenge, has certainly continued as well. So a few headwinds when it comes to construction. I think we still probably see a lot of cranes around us as we do our daily commutes or in the areas we live or work. It might look like things are progressing as normal, but there is that slight dip in the overall crane count amidst what is just rapid population growth. And we're going to talk to demographics and population all the time, aren't we, Ash? Because it's our bread and butter. But the strong population growth, 624,000 people added in the last 12 months, highest record levels there. To see a dip in our construction and approvals right now is sort of a bit concerning when you think we've got to get some supply happening for this strong demand. So I really think the economic conditions aren't favourable at the moment, but I think we've got to look to the future and prepare today for it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, I think you mentioned it before, whether it's a Geoff Brailey dream or a Geoff Brailey very insightful way of living in the future. And I think, you know, as we reflect on how we're going to navigate, like you said, this demand for living here and living conditions and maintaining that in our communities, I'd be keen to hear your reflections, Geoff, as well, or just to further elaborate on what shift you see, I guess, happening in urban development patterns around the future of Australian cities and where that could be heading or where we might be forced to head or how we're going to think about housing these people. But like we said, it's not just about having somewhere safe, which is really important, but somewhere that we can connect with others, where we can live in community and be close to work. There's so many things that go into that livability or decision that someone makes to choose where they live, affordability, of course, as well. But what, yeah, what does that future, I think, for you, what does that look like for you?
Yeah, I think the challenge is when you see just recently there's been some memes around the development in the ponds. There's this photo of all these houses, but they're just stacked right up next to each other. They all look the same. There's no green space in and amongst the houses, let alone in that sort of snapshot of a little community. So it's a terrible thing to try and describe a picture on a podcast. I'm aware it's the challenge of all challenges, but I think the poor quality, low density is going to be the bane of urbanisation, where people are moving to cities, absolutely, but we need to build high quality, livable, connected communities. And they can be detached dwellings or they can be these vertical communities. And I think the challenge as well in places like New South Wales has been the consumer confidence. In a study we did with the Office of the Building Commissioner with Service New South Wales in 2022, was looking at one in three apartment purchasers has confidence in an apartment. One in three. So we just have a massive issue around the endurability of the buildings and things like communication and some kind of rating systems, I think, are ideas that would help. That was what came out in the data. And so the quality of construction, the endurability of it, let alone the master planning. And I think that's where I think the shift we're going to see is that people are going to flock to quality. And that's not just about price. People will certainly look for price. It's the top driver. But I think we're looking for things like community. We're looking for places that have green and blue space around them. And we've done some work many years ago with Clara, and Clara has a vision to build cities that are built from the internet up. And I think if we thought about building cities with renewable energy and from the internet up, these are going to be places that are then just highly attractive to younger generations that are seeking a foot on the property ladder. They're looking for a place that's going to be sustainable to live in, a place that's going to be connected, great for their mental health, great for building community, and great for longevity as well. This, we know we're going to be working and living longer, and so building places that we are attracted to and will live in for a long future will be key. So I think urbanisation is going to be a really interesting trend. We did see that counter trend in the COVID years as people moved to the regions, and that will still continue to happen. For every trend, there's a counter trend. Marx said that famously, and I'd love that saying. And I think the rise of the regions will continue as people disperse out of cities. They've almost been a victim of their own success, but we certainly think, and I think urbanisation, cities are the future. That's where we're going to continue to live. There's so many benefits being in a place that's got the arts, cultures, cafes, sports, all the live events. Regions will do their very best to bring that culture and lifestyle to them. But I think there's just the power of numbers in cities. And so I think that's where we're going to see places. And those cities in Australia, like Adelaide, I think are going to continue to thrive and see those massive cultural experiences, and yet it's got the affordability ladder, it's leveraged. So there's plenty of opportunities for cities across Australia to build great cities in existing places, let alone that dream of imagine what we could create into the future as well.
Mm, absolutely. And I guess a big part of that we often operate in, like you mentioned, Clara, an organisation that we've done some research work for around very similar topics, is I guess the role that research and strategy and planning plays in all of this. And that's from industry bodies to government to lots of different stakeholders who are involved in, I guess, preparing and planning for this. And again, looking at crane numbers, looking at population projections, all of that, of course, plays a role. We believe in that and we know that. Do you have anything else, Geoff, to speak to around, I guess, your thoughts or reflections on the considerations that should be made when it does come to this idea of research and strategy and planning? Like, how are we going to get to this idea that you've mentioned in terms of building communities and cities that ensure the well-being of future generations and communities who, like you said, can afford a place, can afford to build wealth, you know, potentially in property, reimagining that? What are your reflections on how we might get there using research and strategy and planning?
Mm. Yeah, I think the point of strategy is really to align resources to a common end. And so what's the best way to get to the outcome? Well, strategy will consider the options and plan for the best pathway, and a good strategy will evolve, it will change, it will adapt. But Australia is on set some targets around building 1.2 million homes in the next 5 years, but we need to build 6 million homes over the next 25 years. So it's great. We've got a big, bold goal for right now, but if we don't quite get it right, that's okay, because we're still going to need a lot of homes coming up in the next couple of decades. And so I think when it comes to strategy, we've got to think of the different options as a nation. We can add in and do infill development. We'll see plenty of cranes in Sydney, Melbourne, Brisbane, Sunshine Coast, Hobart. We'll see them across all the cap cities, the lifestyle cities. Places will thrive and flourish into the future. But I think we've also got to think beyond just a housing crisis and think of a city opportunity, new city opportunity. And I think a new housing and city strategy. Australia, I think, is a really remarkable place, enormous, beautiful land, but not connected with high-speed rail. I've probably talked on another episode about that another time. But the opportunity to connect people and to build great cities, I think, is a fundamental desire that people move to Australia for. We certainly are a land of new migrants. We've got 31% of people moving from overseas, and India, China, a couple of the top countries of birth. And so the desirability for great apartments in great cities that have lifestyle, they have education, health. We've got to kind of shift from just building housing and figuring out the rest of the missing infrastructure later to these more master planned communities. And I think this is where it's, as demographers, we're looking at the populations, but we need the town planners, we need the architects, the people creating social infrastructure. There's a great need, I think, to bring the best minds together. And I think Australia is ripe for innovation. We're ripe for disruption in the way we build cities and develop for the future. We've got a great opportunity, I think, to maintain great high standards, but also look for those innovative opportunities to try something new and try something different. I think there's an appetite for change. People are a little bit over hearing the broken record of housing affordability challenges, undersupply, tight markets in rental. So I think we've got to try things differently, and the appetite, I think, is pretty strong. And it needs political willpower, but it also, I think, needs that human pressure, and that's what social research can capture. It can capture that desire for change, that pathways and options ahead. And so I think research and strategy work really nicely, almost like the two blades of a scissors. They work together to help cut through the jargon and cut through the mess, and let's carve a better path for the future. And we need to do that, not just for our own generation, but for future generations of people who live in Australia now and people who will move here for a better world, a better life into the future as well.
Wow. Very passionate about this, Geoff, and rightly so. It's a big topic that affects everyone, and whether you're looking to move around in the market or get in the market or move to Australia, like, it impacts so many areas, I think, of our communities. And I think for many parents, I'm sure as well, they're be thinking, and we saw this in the Gen Alpha book we worked on, they're thinking, what's it going to be like for my kids when it comes time for them? If it's tough now, like you said, something needs to hopefully change by the time they're looking and ready to find a home or get in the market or build wealth, you know. And not that all those things have to be connected necessarily, but they are often at the moment in our minds. So yeah, some big challenges and some big conversations all from the Crane data. So fascinating stuff, Geoff. Thank you as always for coming on and posing some great thoughts.
Pleasure. It's great to chat cranes and talk about the future of society and where we live. I love that intro you did. And I think that's exactly the point, that cranes just give a little glimpse into the future of how we'll get around, how we'll reside and where we'll work. So, yeah, thanks for having me on. It's great fun.
Oh, it's, fascinating data that does lead to, I think, insights and topics that we can all relate to and that do impact all of us into the future. So amazing insights, Geoff, as always. Thank you again. And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or you can head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.